And now I think you all have read about Dr. Drake and all of the announcements that we have shared with you. But Michael and I go back to early 70s. He graduated from the UC San Francisco Medical School in 1975, and that was the same year I graduated from the California College of Podiatric Medicine. And I actually met Michael because I used to date one of his classmates back in medical school. He probably doesn't remember all of that. But it was through that particular lens that I met Michael, and I lived with three of the medical students there also. And studying at UC a lot, we developed a good relationship and followed each other's careers over that particular period of time. Had not seen Michael, I guess, prior to around the mid-80s when one of our good friends, Robert Lowry, got married in New York. And in 2000, we had a new president of our health science center in San Antonio, Dr. Francisco Sigueroa. And he had an investiture, and Michael was representing the University of California at that investiture at the health science center in San Antonio. So we reconnected there, talked a little bit, and then as fate would have it, I ended up moving back here in 2007 to become the founding dean of the College of Podiatric Medicine. And so prior to coming here, I called Michael up, and I also called Gene Washington, who's at UCSF, and asked them about coming here and being the dean and getting some insight and perspective. And Michael said, Harkless, come on out and be a chancellor with me and Gene. He said, you're as smart as we are. So I never really thought about being a chancellor, but that kind of inspired me to realize that we can be anything that we would like to be. So I thought it was appropriate to have Michael here. No one is more prepared in terms of working from all the way up through everything to become who he is today. And I won't belabor the point, but please welcome Dr. Michael Drake for our second annual Dean's Lecture. Higher education, healthcare, and the future of America. Dr. Drake.
I think I'll do the Dean Martin thing where I'll kind of walk out and chat with everyone. And I thought, so first, let me say, let me be appropriate and polite and say thank you very much. And thank you very much for the kind introduction and the kind invitation. As Dr. Harkness mentioned, we've known each other for a long time. Actually, someone here who I've known longer, Wesley Curry and I were in college together. So I've known Wesley since then. And Johnson Lightfoot I met when I was in medical school, I think, right? And so the people who I've known for many, many years. And then some others, Frankie, who I just met. Yeah, I just met today. So it's a great range of people I've known from 45 years and then down to 45 minutes. And then others in between. It's also nice to be here and meet several Buckeyes. It's great to travel around and know that there are people who've traveled and passed through similar places during the one's life and times, and good to be here. I wanted to talk about, so how many people here have been to a lecture before? Ever been to a, so some of you haven't. So great, this is your first time. I'm going to try and make it worthwhile. I thought years ago, I was thinking about how many lectures I had attended. And I knew that at the time I was thinking this, that it was thousands. Just routinely, all the time. I spent so many years as a professor, and we go to rounds, and we go to conferences, and so lots and lots of lectures. And if you said, okay, well, you have to remember something that you heard from one or another of them, I could remember something from a handful. So many of them sort of faded into the background. And I thought that today I would try and talk about something a little bit different than the normal lectures and try and give a little perspective that may be different than what you would hear normally. And then I'd love, as we have time at the end, to engage you a bit in conversation. I have a few ideas, and I'd love to hear what you think. What I want to talk about today, really, is the kind of intersections of healthcare and education, and places that I think healthcare is going and I think that education might go and should go. So that's the broad topic. Now, nice to be able to visit Southern California. As the dean mentioned, we lived in Irvine for 9 years, and before that I had been in San Francisco and lived there for many decades and had worked at the office of the president. So I had a chance to be involved in health sciences. Pretty, I think it looks good. I should let you. Am I making it more challenging for you? But okay, well, you let me know. But I had a chance to kind of watch the parallel pathways of health sciences and higher education and to think about them a little bit. One of the questions I get asked a lot is how do you go from being an ophthalmologist to being a chancellor or president of a university? And I'm going to give a talk in a couple of weeks in Washington, and they sent me some of the questions. I'm doing this with a couple of my university colleagues, and the first, there were three of us, president of a university, and they were asking, how do you prepare for such a career? When did you decide that what you were going to do, or how do you line yourself up for it? And I'll be interested to hear what my colleagues have to say. I'll say for me that it was never something that I planned on or thought about, never something I expected to do. I really was focused on my health sciences career and having a good time with it. And it just turned out that I was interested in health sciences, having a great time, but also interested in education. And by being interested in the two, I found myself on committees and other things, and then committees led to chairing committees, and that led to being appointed, testifying here and there, and then I was asked to be vice president for health affairs for the UC system. And then when I was vice president for health affairs for the UC system, my colleagues around the table every week were the other people who were the leaders of the system. And the president had been a chancellor, and at one point he thought it would be a good thing for me to be a chancellor. And I don't want to say, it was a casual thought, it wasn't a whatever. He said, gee, you ought to think about this, and I thought, great. And then one of the openings came up, and I was nominated to have that go to be interviewed. And I thought, well, it'd be fun to be interviewed because, you know, what could go wrong? I mean, what the heck? And maybe you'd learn something, that's a good thing. But I didn't really want the job, and so I went to him, who he was chairing the search committee, and he and I were friends and golfing buddies, and I said, great, I'm going to do the interview, but I just want you to know I don't want to do this. And I knew him well, and I was talking to him in his office, and I said, this is great, I'm going to do this, but I'm doing this because it should be interesting to do, but I'm perfectly happy, I don't want to do this. And he said, fine, you know, just to see how it goes. So we had the interview, and then I got a call the next day saying that they thought we had all had a good time, and next thing we knew, we were in Southern California with campus. Now, let me say, I'm being a little extra casual. I had other positions of leadership and things like that, so it wasn't something that we just sort of fell into, but it really was a different change that I thought I would make. And I would say it took me 2-3 years. 4 years, maybe, to feel less like a medical doctor and more like a university chancellor or president. I felt sort of like a medical doctor playing a chancellor, you know, or masquerading as a chancellor. But I really thought a lot about being my other profession for many years. Over the years, that sort of morphed. And now I feel more like my current job. But deep down inside, I still feel a lot like a medical practitioner. And I think that it helps me a lot at times that are very, very difficult. Two or three things are really great about healthcare and health science and things that I miss a bit and try to carry with me. One that's really a difference between health sciences and many other realms, the business realm, et cetera, something really special is that in health sciences, your colleagues routinely tell you the truth. So that's a great thing. And in fact, you get entirely used to it. You can't imagine one of your colleagues, even one who's a jerk, telling you things that aren't true when it might have to deal with the way that you're going to handle a patient that you're seeing together. People really do tell you the truth because there's a higher order that they are working to. And so the information you tend to get in your business, in your work, in doing your work from your colleagues tends to be true. One of the things that's true then in other fields, and I would say is true for people, particularly in positions of leadership, is that the things that you hear from the people around you are not necessarily true. And in fact, the higher your position of leadership, the less likely it is that what people tell you is going to be true on a consistent basis. So I see people who are chuckling, you're not in positions of leadership, or maybe you actually really are, in fact, and you hear it just exactly the same. It's actually not, it's a drag. And it's a drag because you have to hear what you're hearing and then figure out how to filter it to get down to what is actually really happening. And the most valuable people that you can have around you then are people who will tell you things that are true. And one of the easiest ways to tell who they are is that they'll tell you things that you don't like. Everybody else figures out how to say it so it sounds like what they think you want to hear. And then you really don't have the benefit of having real information to make your decisions on. So that was an interesting change for me to see over time, and to get used to filtering things and try to first find people around me who would tell me things I didn't like, or tell me that I'd made a mistake or that my idea wasn't a good idea. Those are really, really, really valuable people. And then to try to be able to filter things or to create the circumstances where everyone else can feel comfortable telling you things that are true. So in thinking about healthcare and health sciences, it's really a privilege to be able to be in something where truth and integrity are such integral parts of what we do on a daily basis. And that's something I've tried to maintain and to carry through, is to try to make it we could stick with what was true as much as possible, but knowing that you have coming. And you can see it, I think, if you see it today, if you can imagine leaders that you see in different places, just around the country, around the world, making decisions. Imagine the filters that people place on what they say to them as they're trying to pull in information and make decisions, and the real challenge that they have in doing that. And sometimes they do a great job with it and it comes out great. Other times it turns out to be not so good. Another great thing about health sciences and similarity with education is that the thing that we're doing is a really, really good thing. And it's a nearly infinitely good thing. So in health sciences, if you say, gosh, somebody's this healthy, that's good. If they're a little more healthy, that's better. If they're a little healthier, that's... So you kind of, the more health you have, the better your health, it seems like the better. And it's hard to put a value on that. How much is that worth? And it's really not able... You're not able to quantitate it in dollars and cents. Really, more is better. And education is like that as well. Education is a great thing. A little bit of education is great. A little bit more is better. The more you know, the more we like, better education is better. And so there are no real governors on these. And I think that we've seen in both cases that education and healthcare continue to have spiraling costs, and they're difficult things for us to try to be able to control. And so when we think of them and we figure out ways that we're going to control them, we have to try to use other governors, reasonable controls on these systems to try to keep the costs appropriate. So many of you are in school and you have tuition, and tuition is high and tuition continues to go up, and everyone knows that costs in higher education tend to go up faster than the costs in other parts of the society, and that they're really hard to regulate and hold back. It's also true for healthcare. Costs in healthcare tended to rise continually and go up really, really high. And it's hard to put brakes on them and pull them back. Hard to figure out ways to do that. I think that's a big challenge for the country. We've had some attempts at that. One of the attempts at that recently was the Affordable Care Act. And if we roll that back a bit, we can go back to the 1980s. And those of us who are practicing then know that roughly in the 1980s, early 1990s, a couple of things were talked about in healthcare that were new. We started to hear from not people who were purchasing healthcare, but actually businesses that were purchasing healthcare. And these were businesses that were purchasing healthcare for their employees. And they were looking at it more like a benefit, but a commodity, like you can get better or worse healthcare for a better or worse value. And what they wanted to do was to get reasonable healthcare for a good value. And so they began to look around and say, gosh, how do I determine what's good healthcare and how much it's worth? Should I go to St. Elsewhere's Hospital or St. Thomas Hospital? Which one's better? Does it make a difference? How much does it cost to get a gallbladder removed? Does it make a difference? Anybody here ever been to a doctor? Just curious. Some of you not. Huh? So there's, okay, never mind. I won't ask you, but... there was a friend of mine who used to always ask the question, say, how many think it's left? And some people, how many think it's right? And then he said, how many don't think? And I hope that was always somebody left. But most people here have been to a medical practitioner or somebody. How many here have been to a doctor, or somebody in your family has been to a doctor? Let's try that. Okay, we've got a few more hands. And you often consult a doctor for a problem. It can be routine, but you can go and say, gee, I have an issue I'd like to have addressed, or maybe you're going to have a procedure. And how often did you price shop that procedure when you went to do that? That'll be one. How often did you price shop? I won't ask you to answer that, but I will say that routinely, people don't price shop. They don't say, gee, I have a pain in my tummy. I'm going to go and have my gallbladder. Let me look around and see where can I get the best gallbladder price. That's one. he didn't price up. How many of you quality shopped? How many of you said, gee, I want to make sure that I have a good outcome, so I'm going to look for the best gallbladder removing person in town, and I'm going to put the best gallbladder removing person in town and the best price in town and put those things together and make a decision. And I'll say, if you've done that, then you'd be rare. And if you've done that, you've done it recently, because you didn't do that in 1985 or 1990 when it was really unheard of. Now, maybe you did. There are things like that. And also, if you had a procedure in ophthalmology, a procedure like LASIK or something like that, that's a commoditized procedure that's not necessary to help you get over something that's a problem. Those things that are completely discretionary, you tend to shop more. But the vast majority of medicine, the vast majority of patients that we see in our 7 hospitals at the Ohio State University come in as on referral or come in through the ER, come in through one of our clinics. They have no idea how much it's going to cost. They have no information at all on the quality or outcomes of the people that they're seeing. And they put their lives in our hands. So the businesses decided they were going to do something a little bit different, and they were going to say, gee, there must be better and worse healthcare and better and worse value. Let's try and find that out. I'll give you a study. So this is a study that's a study you can remember. Okay. So a study you can remember is that San Francisco, 1970s, yellow cab. The cabs worked better and made more money when they were on the road than when they were in the body shop. Okay, we got two categories: on the road, in the body shop. Money making on the road, no money making, cost money in the body shop. Yellow cab took a bunch of their cabs, I don't know how many they had, I don't remember this, but hundreds, and they put a third brake light in the middle of the trunk. It was strapped on the back of the top of the trunk, ugly and big, but sitting there. And when the driver put the brakes on, this third light would shine bright red in the face of the drivers in back of them. And then they had half of their fleet that didn't have these brake lights. And they looked to see how many of their cabs were rear-ended and went into the shop and were taken off the road. And they were going to study for some period of time. After 3 months, they found that there was an overwhelming degree of protection conveyed by having a third brake light on the back of the cab. It kept and they put them on all the cabs. They stopped the study and said, this keeps people from running into our cabs, keeps our cabs on the road. Let me say, these data and others compelled this to become a law. Every car now has a third brake light. This took years for the law to become a law. But the way it happened was, yellow cab said, we want the cars on the road. We don't want them in the shop. Is this a reasonable protection? Well, the companies started looking at the same thing. Are there things that we can look at hospitals, things we can look at with practitioners that help us determine what the outcomes are going to be and allow us to get better outcomes? And so we started talking about evidence-based medicine. And the evidence-based medicine was, does this work to get that condition better? And we started talking about outcomes-based medicine. If you go to have your gallbladder taken out this hospital versus that one, how long are you in the hospital? Expected readmissions do you have within 30 days? How many people get wound infections, et cetera? And then rolling around in the 1990s, hospitals began to tiptoe into comparing data with one another. F. William Blaisdell, I don't know if anybody here knew F. William Blaisdell. F. William Blaisdell was the chief of surgery at San Francisco General Hospital when I was a medical student. And he was a prototypical 20th century central casting surgeon. And extraordinarily authoritarian, scary, good things like that. And I remember very clearly one morning on rounds, probably 6 o'clock in the morning on a Saturday, when he said there would be a time in the future when surgeons would actually be evaluated on how well their patients did. Oh my goodness gracious. And that stuck in my mind. And 20 years later, we started having to share those data. And 25 years later, hospitals started sharing those data. And so now hospitals share data in consortia all over the country. At the beginning, it started with just a few. You'd have 4 or 5 hospitals who were friends of yours. And you'd say, we'd like to look at the time it takes from the time somebody comes in to the time that they get a cath if they come in with a cardiac condition. Or we want to look at our central line infection rates or things like that that they could compare. They compared them with a few. hospitals. And they were very thoughtful to mask it so that you couldn't find out who was who, and you couldn't be found out on this. You couldn't be public, but very carefully signed up for a secret society of comparing data. And then what people found out is that, gosh, I was doing a pretty darn good job at a 3% central line infection rate, but my friend up the road has a 2% infection rate. And gosh, what are you doing to get a 2% infection rate when I have a 3% infection rate? And then once that was known, the people with the 3% infection rate started doing that, and their rates got down closer to 2. And then the people with the 2% infection rate said, gee, I liked it when I was about 50% better than you. I wonder if I can do something to get my 2 down to 1.5. And so bit by bit, we found that there was a way that hospitals would compete with each other for the right reasons and for pride, et cetera, et cetera. They would compete with each other to try to do a better job when they had the data that let them know how they were doing and began to compare. And now we take thousands of bits of data on our patients. We compare them month by month. We look at things to the hundredth of a decimal point. And we all look together to rate ourselves against hospitals all over the country. And the quality of care, I believe, has improved dramatically. So we found that if we take this thing that's a good commodity and keeps on rising in price until as high as it can possibly go, the people who are looking in a detached way from a third party can sometimes evaluate that and say, I'd like to have value. And they can add value by gathering data to look at what outcomes are. And we've moved way in the last 20 years toward adding outcomes data to what we look at in patients. And there are actually many programs with Medicaid and Medicare, et cetera, which pay you based on the performance that you have. And so we're doing more and more of actually having pay for performance rather than just pay for effort. So I think that's a good thing. I think that makes sense. I think it's good to have data, good to share data, good to learn about what you're doing, good to try to take those data to help yourself learn how to be better. And as I said before, I like things that are true. So good data that are true, I think, can help us all to be better. If we think then about ways that we might continue to improve in healthcare and similarities in healthcare and education, and ways that we might continue to improve in education, we have a lot of very similar pathways. The infinite good, the price pressures continuing to go up, the individual always trying to maximize his or her outcome, but a system perhaps is something that can help to mitigate cost or to control cost. If we look at education, you're all in school. I went to school, my children went to school. Generally, when we look at education, we have a variety of ways that we choose a school to go to. Interestingly, it tends not to be price value coordinated as much as we might think. When I went to college, did I know exactly how much it cost? Now, let me say, there's affordability and can you possibly make it work? And I understand that. Within the range of affordability and can you make it work, was price my primary consideration? And it wasn't my primary consideration. It was trying to go to what I thought was a good college. If I thought of the other colleges that were good colleges, did I have precise information on my pathway or my likelihood of graduation? And I had only a vague notion of those things. And I picked a place that I thought would work. It worked out okay, as it does for most people, and that was a good thing. But I really didn't have scientific data. When you look to the broad array of colleges and universities in the countries, there's a great difference in the success that people have in going to those colleges and universities. There's a study that was done by some colleagues looking at graduation rates. And they found that you could draw a line. They called some colleges more successful and others less successful. And so they decided that 70% six-year graduation rate, 70% six-year graduation rate, was more successful, and below 70% was less successful. That's arbitrary, but 70, whatever. Just how many colleges, 3,000 colleges and universities in the country, how many have a six-year graduation rate of 70% or higher? What percentage? And let me have somebody who's a wonderful person, just give me a guess. Maybe the most wonderful person here will give me a guess. 50%. Let me say, Dr. Lightsford, a round of applause because he's the most wonderful person here. So Johnson has 50% have a six-year graduation rate of 70%. Any other, maybe not the most wonderful person here, but like a really, really wonderful person? Want to make another guess? I'll take a couple more. So 20%, 50%, one more? So 80, 20, and 50. How many people think that one of them got it right? Okay. An alarm went off when somebody raised their hand, and I think for good reason. So the number is 9%. So 91% below, 9% above. And this is a very informed audience. You're a very informed audience. We're at a university. It's the kind of thing all of us would know. I didn't know that. None of us understand that the only 9% of places have a graduation rate of greater than 70%. Interestingly, if you have a profile that's roughly similar to the profile of the students in that school, you tend to graduate at the school you go to, you tend to graduate at about the rate that the other people in the school graduate. Makes sense. Anybody here a runner ever? Runner, great, or a cyclist? So I do a little cycling for fun, and I find if I'm riding along, I have a pace at which I ride, and if I ride faster, or if I'm riding along by myself, I'll tell you the actual truth. I tend to ride about 15 miles an hour if I'm riding on a bike trail. But if I'm on a bike trail and one of my friends comes along, and she's riding at 16 miles an hour, it's easy for me to ride along with her at 16 miles an hour. I don't say, oh, slow down, let's keep it at 15. I kind of can speed it up a little bit and do a little better. And I think if you're running or a lot of things we do, you kind of raise your performance to a more comfortable level that is similar to the performance of people around you to the extent that you can do that. So we find that people who go to colleges with higher graduation rates graduate at a higher rate than somebody with similar background who goes to a college with a lower graduation rate. So it's an interesting thing. We also find that there are things that tend to affect that very strongly, how successful you're going to be in college. So one of the things that affects how successful you're going to be in college is the quality of your instructors. How many people here went to college at one time or another? Just try again. Okay, you're doing great. This is a great good. And when you went to college, how many of you had to pick classes to take to where you had to decide when you were going to take a class? Anybody pick a class? Okay, good. Okay, we're doing fine. Let me say this. I'm gonna give you a hint. Almost every question I ask, you did. Okay, so you can be right nearly 100% of the time. Okay, so when you pick the class, you tend to pick it based on how I did. When I picked the class, I picked on how early that darn lecture was in the morning. Was it 8 o'clock? Oh my goodness, are you kidding me? Or could I group them together so I have a whole afternoon off? Or how far would I have to walk? How often did I group the class based on the quality of the education I was going to get from that professor? I can actually tell you, zero times. 0.0 times. I never said, gee whiz, should I take this class based on the quality of the education I'm going to get there? And there were a couple of reasons I didn't do that. One, I kind of figured it was all going to be about the same, you know, pretty good, and it's going to be all right. And two, I didn't know. I had no way to know. How would I know? And so a lot like healthcare, when you were going to pick a doctor, you'd pick for some variety of reasons, but the real outcome that a person like you would have when they went to a person like that for this particular condition, you didn't know. You bet a whole lot on it. You know, it really needed to work, but you didn't know. Now, we had friends would tell us that they had a good experience, or the person would be at a good place, or all those things have some value, but you really don't know. I work in an organization called the group of university presidents called AAU, Association of American Universities. It's research universities. You'd all know all of them. There are 62 in this group, half public, half private. Meet a couple times a year. And about 5 years ago, I was deputized by the president of the organization. It's in Washington, D.C., deputized to go and meet with a guy named Carl Wieman, who was working in the Office of Science. And he had this crazy idea. He's a Nobel laureate physicist. And he had this crazy idea that higher education should be regulated in some way to look at the quality of your outcomes and to help you to try to do a better job. Oh my goodness gracious, what was wrong with that man? And so I was sent to go and talk to him and talk sense to him. And to say, we appreciate it, but you know, we run these higher education institutions. We really know about it. We're really, really terrific people. We really do a great job. Just take it easy, back off. So I went to talk to him, and I remember this while I went in, and he was kind of distracted scientist, you know, in his office. And I went in, and he said, how you doing? Great to meet you. And he said, what's your graduation rate? I was at UC Irvine, and I told him our graduation rate. He goes, 6 year or 4 year? I told him a 6 year. He said, 4 year. I told him that. He said, that's pretty terrific. What's your endowment level? I was able to tell him the endowment level. He says, that's great. And what kind of majors do you have? And I told him, he says, boy, that's all great stuff. So, gee, you're physics. He's a physicist. So if somebody enters physics as a freshman, how likely are they to graduate in physics? And he looked kind of down, he's scribbling something, and he looked up at me and said, you don't know that, do you? I said, oh, gosh, no, actually, but I can find it out. I can get that information for you. He said, okay, good, good. How about chemistry? How many of them start chemistry? How many of them finish chemistry? And if they leave chemistry, where do they go? And do people who start in other places transfer into chemistry? And they scribbled and said, you don't know that, do you? And I said, no, but you know, I can find that out for you, and I'll be happy to bring that information to you. And he said, so, and how many people, if they start in physics, do they graduate at all? And does it make a difference who they are or who teaches them? I mean, huh, how about that? And I said, and he said, yeah, you don't know that. You know, none of you guys know that. You come in and you tell me about your wonderful statistics and what a great job you're doing. But if I ask you something specific about a student's pathway through your university, you don't have a clue. You don't look at it, you don't care, you don't monitor it, you don't know if this is working well or working poorly. You look at conglomerate evidence at the end, and you don't have a clue about what happens really on the pathway through. And so after the half an hour of being with him, I left as more of a disciple. I didn't do a good job of turning around and talking sense to this, you know, going in to talk sense to this Nobel laureate. He actually talked some sense, I thought, to me. And we began to look at that pathway through school and wondering what kind of things would affect the pathway through school and what might happen to allow you to do a little better. So let me say something that's fascinating to me, startling, interesting information. So when we looked at this deal that there were some colleges did better, colleges that did less well, we looked at who was in the colleges that did better and who was in the colleges that did less well. And we found a couple things were true. One is that 80 to 85% of the people in the colleges that did better were from the upper half of the income distribution. And by statistics, you know that 80 to 85% of the people aren't from the upper half of the income distribution. So there's a skew toward people from the upper half of the income distribution, toward colleges where they're more likely to do well. And in fact, when you looked at students from the lower half of the income distribution, when they went to colleges from the higher half that were in the more successful range, they graduated at rates that were very similar to their classmates in those colleges. When they self-selected or for other reasons went to colleges in the lower that didn't perform as well, they weren't as likely to graduate. The other thing that was fascinating is that the cost of attending the colleges in the upper half or above the line, particularly for students in the lower half of the income distribution, was the same or often much less. I had a conversation with my colleague, president of the University of Washington, Anna Maria Cossey, and Anna said her brother was going to, they lived in Miami, going to Dade County Community College. I think it's called Dade County Community College. It could be called Dade Community College, forgive me if it is. And he was going there, he was paying about $100 a unit or whatever it was at the time, and living at home and figuring he was getting a pretty good affordable education because only $100 a unit or, again, whatever it was at the time. And a friend of his was at Duke, and he said, yeah, I think about going to Duke. He says, great, I'm paying $100 of your money. I'm paying $100 a unit going to Dade Community College and living at home to save money, and Duke is $50,000 a year. Give me a break. He said, well, Duke has this thing that they call, easy to remember, a Duke scholarship. And you ought to think about Duke scholarship. And he said, okay. And he applied for a Duke scholarship. Duke scholarship was tuition, room, board, and incidental, so it was $0 for him to go to Duke. So he transferred to Duke from Dade Community College. Graduated from Duke, became a basketball fan. As a joke. I didn't mean Duke basketball was a joke. I meant, okay, I wouldn't say such a thing. But he graduated from Duke, and it was much less expensive for him to go to there than to stay at home and go to Dade Community College, but he had no way of knowing. And so there are lots of programs out there that are helping, there to help people, but they tend not to know and go to places where they're going to be less successful and pay even more money for that, which is startling. So Northwestern did this great study. So it's the second thing that I, so the first thing I want you to remember is that 9% are above 70% six-year graduation rate. That's interesting. Northwestern, our colleagues at Northwestern, did this fascinating study. They looked at entering freshmen, and they looked at 8 years of entering freshmen, so 16,000, 2,000 students a class, 16,000 students. And they said, does the professor make a difference on the outcome of the student's college experience? Is there a difference between professors? Are there better teachers and not as good teachers? How many people think that there are better teachers and not as good? How many think that some were better and others were worse? Good. So so the optimists all said some were better, and the pessimists didn't say any were better, but they said some were worse. That was good. So what they found was that there was an S-shaped curve. And if I had a slide, I'd put the slide on the S. I'd put a big lazy S on the slide. So in the middle, the professors were about average. At an upward tail, they were better than average. At a downward tail, they were not as good as average. And what determined that? So what they did was something unusual. There are some teachers here. I'm pleased to have won teaching awards. I have them on the wall of my office. I meant a lot to me. If you ask me how much more somebody learned from me in the classes for which I got the teaching awards to the class next door, the professor next door was teaching the same thing, and the person didn't get a teaching award, I don't know. I don't have. Couldn't tell you. I don't know. I don't have a clue, because we never measured how much they learned from me. What we measured was, did they have a good time? Did they think it was fun? Did it seem okay? And they say, yeah, great, and you get a plaque. But that wasn't really the reason that you would go to the class. You go there to try to learn something, and we didn't measure it. Now, we measure it in a way, and that is that the student gets a grade. Student takes a test and gets a grade. So that measures how the student did, but it doesn't measure what I did for the student. And, you know, lawyers, if you go and you're talking, if you were the jury and I was talking to a jury and I did a bad job, and you all said, no, 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 your client's guilty, that the lawyer kind of feels that he or she lost the case. If I'm giving a lecture to everybody and I do a bad job and you don't know it, you all get a bad grade. So it's kind of a different risk-sharing enterprise. So what they did at Northwestern was not look at how the people who took your class evaluated you. They looked at how you did after you took the class. They looked at the outcome, a lot more like what we're trying to do in healthcare, where we look at not how you liked the experience, but what actually happened to you. After you had your knee replaced, could you walk? Could you walk next year? Did you go back to the hospital, et cetera? And so I said knee, I could have, I mean, podiatric medicine, I could have said foot. But did the thing that you did for the patient help the patient get back to his or her life or improve, or did it not make much of a difference for them? So if you did that with education, here's what they did. They said, let's say the class was Econ 1, and you had three people teaching Econ 1. And so you have students come in, you could ask a series of questions. You could say, well, if you were an Econ major and you had Professor McGillicuddy, did you stay as an Econ major, or did you switch to psych or physics or something else? And if you switch to something else, professor gets a minus. If you stayed the same, the professor gets nothing. If you came in as a psych major and you switched to econ, the professor gets a plus. So did people stay with or gravitate to the major after they had your first year class? You got a plus if they did. If they went away, you got a minus. Straightforward. Let's say they were an econ major, they came in and they got a B plus in your class. Well, the first thing you want to see is, again, if they took econ 1, did they take econ 2? And if most of your students took Econ 2, you got a plus. If most didn't, you got a minus. If it was average, you got a zero. And then you could say, well, if you had SAT scores or ACT scores or whatever, and you got a B plus in Econ 1 from Professor McGillicuddy, and you took Econ 2, how'd you do in Econ 2 compared to other people with similar preparation who had other professors for Econ 1? And again, if the average score of somebody who got a B plus in Econ 1 was a B plus in Econ 2, and you got an A minus, your professor gets a plus. If you get a C, your professor gets a minus. And so what you did was you didn't rate the professor based on how well you liked the class. The professor got rated on how you did after taking the class and what you did after taking the class. And a couple things were found with that. First, some were better, most were about the same, and some were worse. And when you looked at the effects, particularly of the next grade that you got, it didn't persist. It wasn't just the grade you got in Econ 2 that was affected by who you had for Econ 1. It was all of your grades and all of your classes for the rest of the college, your entire GPA. If you had a good professor for Econ 1, you graduated, you're more likely to graduate on time, and your overall GPA was higher than predicted. If you had a bad professor, you might not graduate, you might change your major, and your GPA overall, third year, fourth year, was lower than predicted. So it had a profound effect, the beginning professor, on your entire pathway through college. And if you came in with a certain major and a certain life aspiration, and that first class was just a drag and you changed it, it actually could have a profound effect on the rest of your life. So that was the first thing, is that there was a real effect, and it was a lasting effect, shockingly persisting through college. Second thing, the effect, there were some things that would help to determine how strong the effect was. One was your economic background. If you were from a low-income family, or you were the first in your school to go, first in your family to go to college, or you had came from a poorly performing high school, and you had a bad professor, the effects were magnified. Really strong students with good family support, a lot of people went to college, get a bad professor, and they can make it through. They do pretty well. Maybe they don't get as high a grade or whatever, but they can make it through. Those who maybe lacked a little self-confidence, a little practice, etc., would get a bad professor, and it would be poisonous to them. And so when they looked then more carefully, they found that about 7.5% of the professors were just awful. And you just don't want to have that person teach you if you are a low or moderate income student or somebody who came from a struggling high school or the first in your family. Go to that professor and your career is in jeopardy. But we don't gather those data. And the students who are deciding if they're going to go Monday, Wednesday, Friday, or Tuesday, Thursday don't know that when they're checking the box. They might check a box and be lucky, their career is going to zoom. They might check a box and be unlucky. So we're trying to do something about this at our university. We're trying to see if we can focus on teaching and do something to elevate the professors and help them to teach better. And then something we can do to find those who are not really interested in it or don't really do it well and have them teach in areas where we don't have as many vulnerable students, like first-year students in class, and have them teach later on. Now, I'm at the end of my career, more or less. This is my job, my last job, so I can say things like this without being fired immediately. Maybe when I get back, maybe I'll look at my phone, I'll be fired by 6:30. Then I'll spend a little more time here. It's nice here, actually. I was noticing that today. It's springtime. There are palm trees. But it's really a challenge for us to be able to say, gosh, if we had doctors who we knew just weren't getting good outcomes, wouldn't we do something to help protect people from making the mistake of seeing that person, or particularly that person for that problem? Doesn't mean the person doesn't have great value in many other places, other things they can do. But we don't want them to do to be who you happen to get for that particular problem at that particular time. So we set up an institute for teaching and learning. And we started, this is its first year. We have about 70 people going through it. And it's how to learn how to teach better, how to do more with teaching and learn how to teach better. How many people here, let me ask, are professors? Can I just raise your hands proudly? Great, great, great. I have a question I ask with, when people, we have a reception for people who are newly tenured. And when someone's newly tenured, we bring them in and just in chatting, I ask things like, what do you do? And she'll say, I'm a molecular biologist. And I'll say, great. And I'll say, you're tenured, you've got a grant, that's great. How long did it, what did you do to prepare yourself for your first grant? So, well, I did 6 years PhD, 3 years postdocs, so about 9 years of work, and I got the grant, and that was great. And now that we've got these good results, I'm being promoted. That's outstanding. I say, that's really terrific. About how much of your time do you spend in the lab? And typically, she'll say, about half my time in the lab. That's about right. And what do you do the other half? I teach mainly, you know, of course. I do my coursework. I say, gosh, 9 years of preparation to be able to get the grant to fund what you're doing in the lab half your time. How much teacher training did you do? How much preparation did you do to actually learn how to teach? And sometimes they'll say, I did a half-day seminar. You know, have I talked to anybody who did as much as a whole day? Rarely, not at, for the some more senior professors have gone back and revamped classes, but it was never more than a half day or a few hours or whatever else. How much did I do? 0 minutes of actual professional teacher training. And what we see is that, gosh, if it's 9 years to do what you do half the time, shouldn't it be a little bit of time to do what you do the other half the time? So we're setting up something that's going to try to see if we can't put a at least a driver's training like opportunity for people to learn good things about teaching. I teach a freshman seminar. It's a course on the civil rights, the Supreme Court, and the music of the civil rights era. Nothing to do with ophthalmology. My co-teacher is the dean of the law school. We have a good time. And I get to pick who my co-teacher is, so I pick the dean of the law school. The dean of law school and I then get to pick who our TA is. We pick the hardest working workaholic TA we can find. And we say, here's the work. You do all the work. Well, of course we do that, right? I have two advantages. I get a close-in parking place and I get to pick the TA. So we do that. And I noticed last year that I've been teaching this course for 9 years. Last year, the TA was the best we'd ever had. I learned things about some of the lectures or the discussions we were having that I hadn't learned in teaching a class for 8 years. And in casual conversation, I'd learned that she had done Teach for America and had 4 or 5 weeks of actual teacher training, so she knew how to actually teach. She explained to me better than I knew how the Dred Scott case made the Civil War inevitable. And I said, perfectly clear. She did it in 7 minutes. She gave a 7-minute talk that she illustrated, and I said, perfectly clear, there was no choice. And so I'm convinced that good teachers are better than teachers that aren't as good. And I'm convinced that most of us can learn to teach better. I'm certainly, I believe that those who are not wonderful at teaching or wonderful at teaching first and second year students have multiple other great things they can do, like teach graduate students or third and fourth. And so we don't mean that they're not appropriate for the academy, but some people just have a particular facility with helping to stimulate people at the beginning. And we're going to do what we can to try to find who they are and allow them to be in a place to help us all go forward, and to find those who are better doing other things and give our students a better chance of being successful than just randomly checking Monday, Wednesday, Friday, Tuesday, Thursday. I'm going to wind up, and we'll have time for a question or two, but in my wind up, I'm going to say that healthcare and education are a societal good. They're good for the individual, but they make our country better and stronger. They're places where we're real world leaders and we're really, really proud of it. Healthcare and higher education are things that have a value that's nearly infinite, and therefore the cost is rising. Both healthcare and higher education can be evaluated, and we have been slow to move to that, faster now in healthcare, but I think in higher ed it would be great to start doing some evaluation ourselves and to try to do what we can to find information that we can use and apply that information to let people do a better job. The last thing I want to say, and my wrap up before questions, is that the other real thing about healthcare and higher education is that it's a great privilege to be involved in these enterprises. The people that we get to work with are terrific people, trying to do the best, bright, enterprising, wonderful people. The benefit that people who come into our presence have is great benefit for them, and then people become friends and colleagues and almost like an extended family forever. So all of us have this great privilege of being involved in spheres where we get to interact with other people and have it be for their good and to our benefit as well. So we really do have a wonderful privilege, and my hope is that we can take the responsibility of that privilege and keep pushing ourselves to do the very best that we can. Thank you all so very much. Great to be here. So we have time for a question or two.
I don't have any questions. I just have the microphone. Oh, sorry. Oh, sorry. No, no.
Yes. The president has a question.
Dr. Drake.
Yes.
That was spectacular. Thank you. Thank you. It occurs to me there is another arena in which healthcare and education are similarly situated, and that's the likelihood that technology is going to further disrupt the organization and models for each of them. We're seeing it more clearly in health services, but I think it's coming pretty quickly toward the educational arena. Do you have any general or more specific thoughts about that?
Well, I appreciate it. So the question was, other areas where healthcare and education are similar is the fact that technology is having a larger and larger role in what we're doing. And, you know, 100 years ago, certainly, the similarity is that you had the one practitioner who had the knowledge, or the one lecturer who had the knowledge, and you had to be in the presence of that person to get it. They were quite similar. And technology has begun to disrupt very, very actively. My class, the students get an iPad. There's no textbook. All the material is there. It's something that's that we like, and we can actually give them more material, do it better than we could when they were just getting a book. And then it's free. So that's good cost effective. That's value, better, no money. So I think these disruptions are happening very, very actively. And part of our challenge is to continue to, the disruptors are going to be there. Our challenge is to continue to show where we have value that we can add. One of the things we would all think about is the difference between online and in-person classes, for one. And I think that as we actually measure educational outcomes, we'll have the ability to say, gee, teaching in this way or this fashion is better than teaching that way. The students learn more than they would learn otherwise. In the same way we can evaluate technology in healthcare. I was talking to someone just recently who had a hip replacement. And, you know, my day, your day, you know, a hip replacement, down and out for weeks or months to really recover. And now a hip replacement, you tend to be up in some number of hours. You're in the hospital a day or two. You're out and about in the world in a week or two, back to work in a couple of weeks. So we see things moving forward. And I think it's not going to stop. And our job really is to continue to try to innovate in front of the wave. And so I continue to welcome innovation. Anybody here ridden in a driverless car, an autonomous vehicle? So I did.
I just saw one. There was a wreck from Uber yesterday, wasn't it?
What's this?
There was a wreck where they was trying to drive an Uber car that didn't have a driver.
So not me. So mine was actually not an Uber, not one that's out there on the roads. It was actually a Google car, and it had a technician in it, actually, who was near the wheel, but he was holding on to a computer. And what I would say about it is, now you say there was a wreck yesterday with a driverless, with a car, and I think that maybe some of the Teslas that are autonomous, but let me say, were there any wrecks yesterday in cars that had drivers? And I bet you there were more.
That was that scene on TV last night.
Well, one of the things that we found is that, and let me just say with the driverless car, what it was like was driving with like your 15-year-old son or daughter who's about to get a license. So it was awkward. It followed the rules precisely, but didn't have judgment, but it did what it was supposed to. It accelerated a little too quickly. It would put the brakes on a little too hard. It got confused by things here and there, but this was a year and a half ago. It actually drove us around Mountain View for 25 minutes in traffic, and it wasn't so bad. So 2-3 years, 4 years, 5 years from now, pretty good. And there the real risk was the robot-driven car, the computer-driven car, running into a car driven by an unpredictable person. When the robots are communicating with other robots, then the robots aren't going to be stupid, and they're going to work together. Well, I think they're not going to be stupid. Let me say, I really, really, really hope the robots aren't stupid. Or mean. I hope they're not mean or stupid, okay? That would be or evil or crazy. They don't go psychotic, which would be really scary. But where we're going to see this, I think, happen soon will be in trucks. The concept of trucks that can platoon together and drive really close to each other and deliver more stuff in less highway, I think that's a very likely thing to happen, be cost-effective quite soon. And I think these changes are coming, and we have to continue racing ahead to embrace them. There's time for one more. Okay, yes.
Hello, thank you, Dr. Drake, for speaking with us this evening. I had a question on how healthcare tends to digress from many industries. So you kind of touched on this before about how you can't really shop around for the price of how much a appendectomy is going to be or any other procedure. In education, you can actually do that. You can shop around to see what institutions have better ratings or how much you're going to be in debt by the time you graduate. In healthcare, you can't really do that. Do you think that if that was possible, the utilization of healthcare services would decrease? So if people were able to actually say, okay, maybe I'm not going to drink alcohol because this is how much an appendectomy is going to be or whatever. So, yeah, that's the question.
So the question was, looking at the price in comparison with education and healthcare, there are ways that you can do price shopping for education, and appreciate that. And it's more difficult really often to do it for healthcare. Actually, what people can do a little more easily with healthcare is look for quality outcomes, and there are measures of hospitals and ratings, and you can look for, maybe not everyone, but you can look for that. Remember I said there were the 5 or 7% of faculty who were the most dangerous hospitals. You could find the 5 or 7% that are most dangerous. Most do a wonderful job, and I hope I have to remember to say this. If our professors, our students, people do a great job. People love our university. I'm proud of that, and our professors are dedicated and hardworking. The question is only, could you be even better? And my guess is that most of us could be even better, but let's find out and see if we can try to do that. And So let me answer two questions. The first is, I believe that healthcare will continue to share data with us that you can use as a consumer to make better decisions. It's better now than it was 10 or 15 years ago. I think it'll be better 10 or 15 years from now, and I think that's a good thing. Plus, no one likes to talk about regulators, but as we have regulators, the regulators can also make sure that there's a minimum standard that people have to meet. That's already done. I think that actually can get a little bit better. For education, I deal with legislators a lot, and they'll often say to me, we want the price of education to be down. You all are too expensive. We're going to want to control your budget, et cetera, et cetera. When I talk to them and I say, where's your daughter? What's your daughter doing? And they say, my daughter is going to college. And if I said, gee, you were really interested in our cost being as low as possible. Did your daughter go to the cheapest college she could find? And are you proud of how little you're paying for her to go to college? And I will tell you that 0.0 of them will do that. So what they tell us is what we care about is the price. When they were picking a college for their daughter or their son, they picked it based on the quality and the value. And I think that we ought to have ways to share with people broadly the quality and the value, and then allow you to make reasonable decisions going forward. And our Institute for Teaching and Learning, our evaluative processes, the data analytics that we are putting into place, we hope will help us do a better job of telling people where there's quality and where there's value. I know that it's time for me to go. It's been great visiting all of you. Thank you very, very much. Appreciate it.
Thank you, Michael. A stimulating discussion. If I summarize them from a family of educators, and when I left Texas moving here, my brother was a school teacher and principal, all that. He said, Harkless, now Lawrence, there are 4 things you didn't know as a dean. What do you want them to know? How do you know they learn? How do you remediate? And how do you enrich? And then for the students, my grandmother always told us 2 things: always follow your heart and serve your community. And so if I summarize Dr. Drake's talk, it's about the teaching learning process, and it and teaching, research, and service are the 3 major missions of a university. And so he talked about the professor in terms of the education and the research, but the big key is service. And similar to what he was telling you, what happened to him over his career and how he became the chancellor, it was pretty simple. He served, and as he served, somebody saw he had talent and gave him more opportunities to serve. And that's my story too. And I think that if we all shared that, that's probably the most stories. So I think that for the students and everybody here, really think about that. And then he talked about evidence base and how do we know that you know. Now, I was so scared as a assistant professor that I didn't know how to teach, so I took every class that the University of Texas had that I could learn how to teach. And I was scared. I took a 10 milligram valium the first time I gave a lecture. And I'm going to stop on that. But I hope that I summarize adequately the essence of what he said. One thing, Ralph Waldo Emerson had one quote: He said, what lies in front of you and what lies behind you are tiny matters compared to what's in you. And my brother always asked me, is it in you? So if it's in you, go teach, go learn, and do the things that he's doing so that we can make it better. My biggest challenge is to getting podiatrists to want to be academicians. That's the hardest job because everybody want to go make money. But money follows excellence as he's the chancellor over all the things that he did for serving. And I don't know how much he makes as a chancellor, but he's making more money he ever dreamed he'd make when he need the lease. Am I right, Michael? He thinks so, yeah. So Michael, thank you for coming. Give Michael a good hand again for coming and sharing with us. So we have our Dean's plaque here. We have here Michael Drake, 2017. Julie Frieslag was our inaugural lecturer. You know Julie from Davis and that. Okay. Do it this way. How's that? Yeah. I'm a little. It's good. And one more. I got another little plaque here.